Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Human Condition, Second Edition, by Hannah Arendt, narrated by Elizabeth Wiley. Prologue. In 1957, an Earth-born object made by man was launched into the universe, where for some weeks it circled the Earth according to the same laws of gravitation that swing and keep in motion the celestial bodies, the sun, the moon, and the stars. To be sure, the man-made satellite was no moon or star, no heavenly body which could follow its circling path for a time span that, to us mortals, bound by earthly time, lasts from eternity to eternity. Yet for a time, it managed to stay in the skies. It dwelt and moved in the proximity of the heavenly bodies as though it had been admitted tentatively to their sublime company. This event, second in importance to no other, not even to the splitting of an atom, would have been greeted with unmitigated joy if it had not been for the uncomfortable military and political circumstances attending it. But curiously enough, this joy was not triumphal. It was not pride or awe at the tremendousness of human power and mastery which filled the hearts of men, who now, when they looked up from the earth toward the skies, could behold there a thing of their own making. The immediate reaction, expressed on the spur of the moment, was relief about the first step toward escape from man's imprisonment to the earth. And this strange statement, far from being the accidental slip of some American reporter, unwittingly echoed the extraordinary line which, more than 20 years ago, had been carved on the funeral obelisk for one of Russia's great scientists: "Mankind will not remain bound to the earth forever." Such feelings have been commonplace for some time. They show that men everywhere are by no means slow to catch up and adjust to scientific discoveries and technical developments, but that, on the contrary, they have outsped them by decades. Here, as in other respects, science has realized and affirmed what men anticipated in dreams that were neither wild nor idle. What is new is only that one of this country's most respectable newspapers finally brought to its front page what up to then had been buried in the highly non-respectable literature of science fiction, to which, unfortunately, nobody has yet paid the attention it deserves as a vehicle of mass sentiments and mass desires. The banality of the statement should not make us overlook how extraordinary, in fact, it was. For although Christians have spoken of the earth as a veil of tears, and philosophers have looked upon their body as a prison of mind or soul, nobody in the history of mankind has ever conceived of the earth as a prison for men's bodies, or shown such eagerness to go literally from here to the moon. Should the emancipation and secularization of the modern age, which began with a turning away, not necessarily from God, but from a God who was the Father of men in heaven, end with an even more fateful repudiation of an earth who was the mother of all living creatures under the sky? The earth is the very quintessence of the human condition. And earthly nature, for all we know, may be unique in the universe in providing human beings with a habitat in which they can move and breathe without effort and without artifice. The human artifice of the world separates human existence from all mere animal environment, but life itself is outside this artificial world, and through life, man remains related to all other living organisms. For some time now, a great many scientific endeavors have been directed toward making life also artificial, toward cutting the last tie through which even man belongs among the children of nature. It is the same desire to escape from imprisonment to the earth that is manifest in the attempt to create life in the test tube, in the desire to mix frozen germ plasm from people of demonstrated ability under the microscope to produce superior human beings, to alter their size, shape, and function. And the wish to escape the human condition, I suspect, also underlies the hope to extend man's lifespan far beyond the 100-year limit. This future man, whom the scientists tell us they will produce in no more than 100 years, seems to be possessed by a rebellion against human existence as it has been given, a free gift from nowhere, secularly speaking, which he wishes to exchange, as it were, for something he has made himself. There is no reason to doubt our abilities to accomplish such an exchange, just as there is no reason to doubt our present ability to destroy all organic life on Earth. The question is only whether we wish to use our new scientific and technical knowledge in this direction, and this question cannot be decided by scientific means. It is a political question of the first order, and therefore can hardly be left to the decision of professional scientists or professional politicians. While such possibilities may still lie in a distant future, the first boomerang effects of science's great triumphs have made themselves felt in a crisis within the natural sciences themselves. The trouble concerns the fact that the truths of the modern scientific worldview, though they can be demonstrated in mathematical formulas and proved technologically, will no longer lend themselves to normal expression in speech and thought. The moment these truths are spoken of conceptually and coherently, the resulting statements will be not perhaps as meaningless as a triangular circle, but much more so than a winged lion, Erwin Schrödinger. We do not yet know whether this situation is final, but it could be that we who are earthbound creatures and have begun to act as though we were dwellers of the universe will forever be unable to understand, that is, to think and speak about the things which, nevertheless, we are able to do. In this case, it would be as though our brain, which constitutes the physical material condition of our thoughts, were unable to follow what we do, so that from now on, we would indeed need artificial machines to do our thinking and speaking. If it should turn out to be true that knowledge, in the modern sense of know-how, and thought have parted company for good, then we would indeed become the helpless slaves, not so much of our machines as of our know-how, thoughtless creatures at the mercy of every gadget which is technically possible, no matter how murderous it is. However, even apart from these last and yet uncertain consequences, the situation created by the sciences is of great political significance. Wherever the relevance of speech is at stake, matters become political by definition, for speech is what makes man a political being. If we would follow the advice, so frequently urged upon us, to adjust our cultural attitudes to the present status of scientific achievement, we would, in all earnest, adopt a way of life in which speech is no longer meaningful. For the sciences today have been forced to adopt a language of mathematical symbols, which, though it was originally meant only as an abbreviation for spoken statements, now contains statements that in no way can be translated back into speech. The reason why it may be wise to distrust the political judgment of scientists qua scientists is not primarily their lack of character, that they did not refuse to develop atomic weapons, or their naivete, that they did not understand that once these weapons were developed, they would be the last to be consulted about their use, but precisely the fact that they move in a world where speech has lost its power. And whatever men do or know or experience can make sense only to the extent that it can be spoken about. There may be truths beyond speech, and they may be of great relevance to man in the singular, that is, to man insofar as he is not a political being, whatever else he may be. Men in the plural, that is, men insofar as they live and move and act in this world, can experience meaningfulness only because they can talk with and make sense to each other and to themselves. Closer at hand, and perhaps equally decisive, is another no less threatening event. This is the advent of automation, which in a few decades probably will empty the factories and liberate mankind from its oldest and most natural burden, the burden of laboring and the bondage to necessity. Here, too, a fundamental aspect of the human condition is at stake, but the rebellion against it, the wish to be liberated from labor's toil and trouble, is not modern, but as old as recorded history. Freedom from labor itself is not new. It once belonged among the most firmly established privileges of the few. In this instance, it seems as though scientific progress and technical developments had been only taken advantage of to achieve something about which all former ages dreamed, but which none had been able to realize. However, this is so only in appearance. The modern age has carried with it a theoretical glorification of labor, and has resulted in a factual transformation of the whole society into a laboring society. The fulfillment of the wish, therefore, like the fulfillment of wishes in fairy tales, comes at a moment when it can only be self-defeating. It is a society of laborers which is about to be liberated from the fetters of labor, and this society does no longer know of those other higher and more meaningful activities, for the sake of which this freedom would deserve to be won. Within this society, which is egalitarian because this is labor's way of making men live together, there is no class left, no aristocracy of either a political or spiritual nature, from which a restoration of the other capacities of man could start anew. Even presidents, kings, and prime ministers think of their offices in terms of a job necessary for the life of society, and among the intellectuals, only solitary individuals are left who consider what they are doing in terms of work, and not in terms of making a living. What we are confronted with is the prospect of a society of laborers without labor, that is, without the only activity left to them. Surely nothing could be worse. To these preoccupations and perplexities, this book does not offer an answer. Such answers are given every day, and they are matters of practical politics, subject to the agreement of many. They can never lie in theoretical considerations or the opinion of one person, as though we dealt here with problems for which only one solution is possible. What I propose in the following is a reconsideration of the human condition from the vantage point of our newest experiences and our most recent fears. This, obviously, is a matter of thought. And thoughtlessness, the heedless recklessness or hopeless confusion or complacent repetition of truths which have become trivial and empty, seems to me among the outstanding characteristics of our time. What I propose, therefore, is very simple. It is nothing more than to think what we are doing. What we are doing is indeed the central theme of this book. It deals only with the most elementary articulations of the human condition, with those activities that traditionally, as well as according to a current opinion, are within the range of every human being. For this and other reasons, the highest and perhaps purest activity of which men are capable, the activity of thinking, is left out of these present considerations. Systematically, therefore, the book is limited to a discussion of labor, work, and action, which forms its three central chapters. Historically, I deal in a last chapter with the modern age, and throughout the book with the various constellations within the hierarchy of activities as we know them from Western history. However, the modern age is not the same as the modern world. Scientifically, the modern age, which began in the 17th century, came to an end at the beginning of the 20th century. Politically, the modern world in which we live today was born with the first atomic explosions. I do not discuss this modern world, against whose background this book was written. I confine myself, on the one hand, to an analysis of those general human capacities which grow out of the human condition and are permanent, that is, which cannot be irretrievably lost so long as the human condition itself is not changed. The purpose of the historical analysis, on the other hand, is to trace back modern world alienation, its twofold flight from the earth into the universe, and from the world into the self, to its origins, in order to arrive at an understanding of the nature of society as it had developed and presented itself at the very moment when it was overcome by the advent of a new and yet unknown age. Chapter 1. The Human Condition. 1. Vita Activa and the Human Condition. With the term Vita Activa, I propose to designate three fundamental human activities: labor, work, and action. They are fundamental because each corresponds to one of the basic conditions under which life on earth has been given to man. Labor is the activity which corresponds to the biological process of the human body, whose spontaneous growth, metabolism, and eventual decay are bound to the vital necessities produced and fed into the life process by labor. The human condition of labor is life itself. Work is the activity which corresponds to the unnaturalness of human existence, which is not embedded in and whose mortality is not compensated by the species' ever-recurring life cycle. Work provides an artificial world of things distinctly different from all natural surroundings. Within its borders, each individual life is housed, while this world itself is meant to outlast and transcend them all. The human condition of work is worldliness. Action, the only activity that goes on directly between men without the intermediary of things or matter, corresponds to the human condition of plurality, to the fact that men, not man, live on the earth and inhabit the world. While all aspects of the human condition are somehow related to politics, this plurality is specifically the condition, not only the conditio sine qua non, but the conditio per quam, of all political life. Thus, the language of the Romans, perhaps the most political people we have known, used the words to live and to be among men, inter homines esse, or to die and to cease to be among men, inter homines esse desinere, as synonyms. But in its most elementary form, the human condition of action is implicit even in Genesis. Male and female he created them. if we understand that this story of man's creation is distinguished in principle from the one according to which God originally created man, Adam, him and not them, so that the multitude of human beings becomes the result of multiplication. Action would be an unnecessary luxury, a capricious interference with general laws of behavior, if men were endlessly reproducible repetitions of the same model, whose nature or essence was the same for all, and as predictable as the nature or essence of any other thing. Plurality is the condition of human action, because we are all the same, that is, human, in such a way that nobody is ever the same as anyone else who ever lived, lives, or will live. Note: in the analysis of post-classical political thought, it is often quite illuminating to find out which of the two biblical versions of the creation story is cited. Thus, it is highly characteristic of the difference between the teaching of Jesus of Nazareth and of Paul that Jesus, discussing the relationship between man and wife, refers to Genesis chapter 1, verse 27. Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? Matthew chapter 19, verse 4. Whereas Paul, on a similar occasion, insists that the woman was created of the man, and hence for the man, even though he then somewhat attenuates the dependence, neither is the man without the woman, neither the woman without the man. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 8 through 12. The difference indicates much more than a different attitude to the role of woman. For Jesus, faith was closely related to action. For Paul, faith was primarily related to salvation. Especially interesting in this respect is Augustine, who not only ignores Genesis chapter 1, verse 27 altogether, but sees the difference between man and animal in that man was created unum ac singulum, whereas all animals were ordered to come into being several at once, plura simul jussit existere. To Augustine, the creation story offers a welcome opportunity to stress the species character of animal life as distinguished from the singularity of human existence. All three activities and their corresponding conditions are intimately connected with the most general condition of human existence, birth and death, natality and mortality. Labor assures not only individual survival, but the life of the species. Work and its product, the human artifact, bestow a measure of permanence and durability upon the futility of mortal life and the fleeting character of human time. Action, insofar as it engages in founding and preserving political bodies, creates the condition for remembrance, that is, for history. Labor and work, as well as action, are also rooted in natality, insofar as they have the task to provide and preserve the world for, to foresee and reckon with, the constant influx of newcomers who are born into the world as strangers. However, of the three, action has the closest connection with the human condition of natality. The new beginning inherent in birth can make itself felt in the world only because the newcomer possesses the capacity of beginning something anew, that is, of acting. In this sense of initiative, an element of action, and therefore of natality, is inherent in all human activities. Moreover, since action is the political activity par excellence, natality and not mortality may be the central category of political as distinguished from metaphysical thought. The human condition comprehends more than the conditions under which life has been given to man. Men are conditioned beings because everything they come in contact with turns immediately into a condition of their existence. The world in which the vita activa spends itself consists of things produced by human activities. But the things that owe their existence exclusively to men nevertheless constantly condition their human makers. In addition to the conditions under which life is given to man on earth and partly out of them, men constantly create their own self-made conditions, which, their human origin and their variability notwithstanding, possess the same conditioning power as natural things. Whatever touches or enters into a sustained relationship with human life immediately assumes the character of a condition of human existence. This is why men, no matter what they do, are always conditioned beings. Whatever enters the human world of its own accord, or is drawn into it by human effort, becomes part of the human condition. The impact of the world's reality upon human existence is felt and received as a conditioning force. The objectivity of the world, its object or thing character, and the human condition supplement each other. Because human existence is conditioned existence, it would be impossible without things, and things would be a heap of unrelated articles, a non-world, if they were not the conditioners of human existence. To avoid misunderstanding, the human condition is not the same as human nature, and the sum total of human activities and capabilities which correspond to the human condition does not constitute anything like human nature. For neither those we discuss here nor those we leave out, like thought and reason, and not even the most meticulous enumeration of them all, constitute essential characteristics of human existence in the sense that without them, this existence would no longer be human. The most radical change in the human condition we can imagine would be an emigration of men from the earth to some other planet. Such an event, no longer totally impossible, would imply that man would have to live under man-made conditions radically different from those the earth offers him. Neither labor, nor work, nor action, nor indeed thought as we know it, would then make sense any longer. Yet even these hypothetical wanderers from the earth would still be human. But the only statement we could make regarding their nature is that they are still conditioned beings, even though their condition is now self-made to a considerable extent. The problem of human nature, the Augustinian quaestio mihi factu sum, a question have I become for myself, seems unanswerable in both its individual psychological sense and its general philosophical sense. It is highly unlikely that we, who can know, determine, and define the natural essences of all things surrounding us, which we are not, should ever be able to do the same for ourselves. This would be like jumping over our own shadows. Moreover, nothing entitles us to assume that man has a nature or essence in the same sense as other things. In other words, if we have a nature or essence, then surely only a god could know and define it. And the first prerequisite would be that he be able to speak about a who as though it were a what. Note, Augustine, who is usually credited with having been the first to raise the so-called anthropological question in philosophy, knew this quite well. He distinguishes between the questions of who am I and what am I, the first being directed by man at himself, and I directed myself at myself, and said to me, you, who are you? And I answered, a man. Tu quis es? And the second being addressed to God, what then am I, my God? What is my nature? Quid ergo sum, Deus meus? Quae natura sum? For in the great mystery, the grande profundum, which man is, there is something of man, aliquid hominis, which the spirit of man which is in him itself knoweth not. But thou, Lord, who has made him, fecisti eum, knowest everything of him, eius omnia. Thus, the most familiar of these phrases, which I quoted in the text, the quaestio mihi factus sum, is a question raised in the presence of God, in whose eyes I have become a question for myself. In brief, the answer to the question, who am I, is simply, you are a man, whatever that may be. And the answer to the question, what am I, can be given only by God who made man. The question about the nature of man is no less a theological question than the question about the nature of God. Both can be settled only within the framework of a divinely revealed answer. The perplexity is that the modes of human cognition applicable to things with natural qualities, including ourselves to the limited extent that we are specimens of the most highly developed species of organic life, fail us when we raise the question, and who are we? This is why attempts to define human nature almost invariably end with some construction of a deity, that is, with the god of the philosophers who, since Plato, has revealed himself upon closer inspection to be a kind of platonic idea of man. Of course, to demask such philosophic concepts of the divine as conceptualizations of human capabilities and qualities is not a demonstration of, not even an argument for, the non-existence of God, but the fact that attempts to define the nature of man lead so easily into an idea which definitely strikes us as superhuman, and therefore is identified with the divine, may cast suspicion upon the very concept of human nature. On the other hand, the conditions of human existence, life itself, natality and mortality, worldliness, plurality, and the earth, can never explain what we are or answer the question of who we are for the simple reason that they never condition us absolutely. This has always been the opinion of philosophy, in distinction from the sciences, anthropology, psychology, biology, etc., which also concern themselves with man. But today we may almost say that we have demonstrated, even scientifically, that though we live now, and probably always will, under the Earth's conditions, we are not mere earthbound creatures. Modern natural science owes its great triumphs to having looked upon and treated earthbound nature from a truly universal viewpoint, that is, from an Archimedean standpoint taken willfully and explicitly outside the Earth. 2. The term vita activa. The term vita activa is loaded and overloaded with tradition. It is as old as, but not older than, our tradition of political thought. And this tradition, far from comprehending and conceptualizing all the political experiences of Western mankind, grew out of a specific historical constellation, the trial of Socrates and the conflict between the philosopher and the polis. It eliminated many experiences of an earlier past that were irrelevant to its immediate political purposes, and proceeded until its end in the work of Karl Marx in a highly selective manner. The term itself, in medieval philosophy the standard translation of the Aristotelian bios politikos, already occurs in Augustine, where, as vita negotiosa or actuosa, it still reflects its original meaning, a life devoted to public political matters. Aristotle distinguished three ways of life, bioi, which men might choose in freedom, that is, in full independence of the necessities of life and the relationships they originated. This prerequisite of freedom rules out all ways of life chiefly devoted to keeping one's self alive, not only labor, which was the way of life of the slave, who was coerced by the necessity to stay alive and by the rule of his master, but also the working life of the free craftsman and the acquisitive life of the merchant. In short, it excluded everybody who involuntarily or voluntarily, for his whole life or temporarily, had lost the free disposition of his movements and activities. Note: William L. Westerman holds that the state of Aristotle that craftsmen live in a condition of limited slavery meant that the artisan, when he made a work contract, disposed of two of the four elements of his free status, that is, of freedom of economic activity and right of unrestricted movement, but by his own volition and for a temporary period. Evidence quoted by Westerman shows that freedom was then understood to consist of status, personal inviolability, freedom of economic activity, right of unrestricted movement. And slavery, consequently, was the lack of these four attributes. Aristotle, in his enumeration of ways of life in the Nicomachean Ethics and the Eudemian Ethics, does not even mention a craftsman's way of life. To him, it is obvious that a banausos is not free. He mentions, however, the life of money-making, and rejects it because it too is undertaken under compulsion. That the criterion is freedom is stressed in the Eudemian Ethics. He enumerates only those lives that are chosen ep exousion. The remaining three ways of life have in common that they were concerned with the beautiful, that is, with things neither necessary nor merely useful, the life of enjoying bodily pleasures in which the beautiful, as it is given, is consumed, the life devoted to the matters of the polis, in which excellence produces beautiful deeds, and the life of the philosopher, devoted to inquiry into and contemplation of things eternal, whose everlasting beauty can neither be brought about through the producing interference of man, nor be changed through his consumption of them. The chief difference between the Aristotelian and the later medieval use of the term is that the bios politikos denoted explicitly only the realm of human affairs, stressing the action, praxis, needed to establish and sustain it. Neither labor nor work was considered to possess sufficient dignity to constitute a bios at all, an autonomous and authentically human way of life. Since they served and produced what was necessary and useful, they could not be free, independent of human needs and wants. That the political way of life escaped this verdict is due to the Greek understanding of polis life, which to them denoted a very special and freely chosen form of political organization, and by no means just any form of action necessary to keep men together in an orderly fashion. Not that the Greeks or Aristotle were ignorant of the fact that human life always demands some form of political organization, and that ruling over subjects might constitute a distinct way of life. But the despot's way of life, because it was merely a necessity, could not be considered free, and had no relationship with the bios politikos. With the disappearance of the ancient city-state, Augustine seems to have been the last to know at least what it once meant to be a citizen. The term vita activa lost its specifically political meaning and denoted all kinds of active engagement in the things of this world. To be sure, it does not follow that work and labor had risen in the hierarchy of human activities and were now equal in dignity with a life devoted to politics. It was rather the other way round. Action was now also reckoned among the necessities of earthly life, so that contemplation, the bios theoreticos, translated into the vita contemplativa, was left as the only truly free way of life. However, the enormous superiority of contemplation over activity of any kind, action not excluded, is not Christian in origin. We find it in Plato's political philosophy, where the whole utopian reorganization of polis life is not only directed by the superior insight of the philosopher, but has no aim other than to make possible the philosopher's way of life. Aristotle's very articulation of the different ways of life, in whose order the life of pleasure plays a minor role, is clearly guided by the idea of contemplation, theoria. To the ancient freedom from the necessities of life, from the compulsion by others, the philosophers added freedom and surcease from political activity, skole. So that the later Christian claim to be free from entanglement in worldly affairs, from all the business of this world, was preceded by and originated in the philosophic apolitia of late antiquity. What had been demanded only by the few was now considered to be a right of all. Note: the Greek word skole, like the Latin otium, means primarily freedom from political activity and not simply leisure time, although both words are also used to indicate freedom from labor and life's necessities. In any event, they always indicate a condition free from worries and cares. An excellent description of the everyday life of an ordinary Athenian citizen, who enjoys full freedom from labor and work, can be found in Fustel de Coulonge, The Ancient City, pages 334 to 336. It will convince everybody how time-consuming political activity was under the conditions of the city-state. One can easily guess how full of worry this ordinary political life was if one remembers that Athenian law did not permit remaining neutral, and punished those who did not want to take sides in factional strife with loss of citizenship. The term vita activa, comprehending all human activities and defined from the viewpoint of the absolute quiet of contemplation, therefore corresponds more closely to the Greek ascholia, unquiet, with which Aristotle designated all activity, than to the Greek bios politikos. As early as Aristotle, the distinction between quiet and unquiet, between an almost breathless abstention from external physical movement and activity of every kind, is more decisive than the distinction between the political and the theoretical way of life, because it can eventually be found within each of the three ways of life. It is like the distinction between war and peace. Just as war takes place for the sake of peace, thus every kind of activity, even the processes of mere thought, must culminate in the absolute quiet of contemplation. Every movement, the movements of body and soul, as well as of speech and reasoning, must cease before truth. Truth, be it the ancient truth of being or the Christian truth of the living God, can reveal itself only in complete human stillness. Note: Aquinas stresses the stillness of the soul and recommends the vita activa because it exhausts and therefore quietens interior passions and prepares for contemplation. Traditionally, and up to the beginning of the modern age, the term vita activa never lost its negative connotation of unquiet, nec otium ascolia. As such, it remained intimately related to the even more fundamental Greek distinction between things that are by themselves, whatever they are, and things which owe their existence to man, between things that are physē and things that are nomō. The primacy of contemplation over activity rests on the conviction that no work of human hands can equal in beauty and truth the physical cosmos, which swings in itself in changeless eternity without any interference or assistance from outside, from man or God. This eternity discloses itself to mortal eyes only when all human movements and activities are at perfect rest. Compared with this attitude of quiet, all distinctions and articulations within the vita activa disappear. Seen from the viewpoint of contemplation, it does not matter what disturbs the necessary quiet, as long as it is disturbed. Traditionally, therefore, the term vita activa receives its meaning from the vita contemplativa. Its very restricted dignity is bestowed upon it because it serves the needs and wants of contemplation in a living body. Note: Aquinas is quite explicit on the connection between the vita activa and the wants and needs of the human body, which men and animals have in common. Christianity, with its belief in a hereafter whose joys announce themselves in the delights of contemplation, conferred a religious sanction upon the abasement of the vita activa to its derivative secondary position. But the determination of the order itself coincided with the very discovery of contemplation, theoria, as a human faculty distinctly different from thought and reasoning, which occurred in the Socratic school, and from then on has ruled the metaphysical and political thought throughout our tradition. Note: Augustine speaks of the burden, sarcina, of active life imposed by the duty of charity, which would be unbearable without the sweetness, suavitas, and the delight of truth given in contemplation. Note: The time-honored resentment of the philosopher against the human condition of having a body is not identical with the ancient contempt for the necessities of life. To be subject to necessity was only one aspect of bodily existence, and the body, once freed of this necessity, was capable of that pure appearance the Greeks called beauty. The philosophers since Plato added to the resentment of being forced by bodily wants the resentment of movement of any kind. It is because the philosopher lives in complete quiet that it is only his body which, according to Plato, inhabits the city. Here lies also the origin of the early reproach of busybodiness, polypragmasini, leveled against those who spent their lives in politics. It seems unnecessary to my present purpose to discuss the reasons for this tradition. Obviously, they are deeper than the historical occasion which gave rise to the conflict between the polis and the philosopher, and thereby, almost incidentally, also led to the discovery of contemplation as the philosopher's way of life. They must lie in an altogether different aspect of the human condition, whose diversity is not exhausted in the various articulations of the vita activa, and, we may suspect, would not be exhausted even if thought and the movement of reasoning were included in it. If, therefore, the use of the term vita activa, as I propose it here, is in manifest contradiction to the tradition, it is because I doubt not the validity of the experience underlying the distinction, but rather the hierarchical order inherent in it from its inception. This does not mean that I wish to contest or even to discuss, for that matter, the traditional concept of truth as revelation, and therefore something essentially given to man, or that I prefer the modern age's pragmatic assertion that man can only know what he makes himself. My contention is simply that the enormous weight of contemplation in the traditional hierarchy has blurred the distinctions and articulations within the vita activa itself, and that, appearances notwithstanding, this condition has not been changed essentially by the modern break with the tradition and the eventual reversal of its hierarchical order in Marx and Nietzsche. It lies in the very nature of the famous turning upside down of philosophic systems, or currently accepted values, that is, in the nature of the operation itself, that the conceptual framework is left more or less intact. The modern reversal shares with the traditional hierarchy the assumption that the same central human preoccupation must prevail in all activities of men, since without one comprehensive principle, no order could be established. This assumption is not a matter of course, and my use of the term vita activa presupposes that the concern underlying all its activities is not the same as, and is neither superior nor inferior to the central concern of the vita contemplativa. 3. Eternity versus immortality. That the various modes of active engagement in the things of this world on one side, and pure thought culminating in contemplation on the other, might correspond to two altogether different central human concerns, has, in one way or another, been manifest ever since the men of thought and the men of action began to take different paths, that is, since the rise of political thought in the Socratic school. However, when the philosophers discovered, and it is probable, though unprovable, that this discovery was made by Socrates himself, that the political realm did not, as a matter of course, provide for all of man's higher activities, they assumed at once not that they had found something different in addition to what was already known, but that they had found a higher principle to replace the principle that ruled the polis. The shortest, albeit somewhat superficial, way to indicate these two different and to an extent even conflicting principles is to recall the distinction between immortality and eternity. Immortality means endurance in time, deathless life on this earth and in this world as it was given, according to Greek understanding, to nature and the Olympian gods. Against this background of nature's ever-recurring life and the gods' deathless and ageless lives stood mortal men, the only mortals in an immortal but not eternal universe, confronted with the immortal lives of their gods, but not under the rule of an eternal god. If we trust Herodotus, the difference between the two seems to have been striking to Greek self-understanding prior to the conceptual articulation of the philosophers, and therefore prior to the specifically Greek experiences of the eternal, which underlie this articulation. Herodotus, discussing Asiatic forms of worship and beliefs in an invisible god, mentions explicitly that compared with this transcendent god, as we would say today, who is beyond time and life and the universe, the Greek gods are anthropophies, have the same nature, not simply the same shape, as man. The Greeks' concern with immortality grew out of their experience of an immortal nature and immortal gods, which together surrounded the individual lives of mortal men. Embedded in a cosmos where everything was immortal, mortality became the hallmark of human existence. Men are the mortals, the only mortal things in existence, because unlike animals, they do not exist only as members of a species whose immortal life is guaranteed through procreation. The mortality of men lies in the fact that individual life, with a recognizable life story from birth to death, rises out of biological life. This individual life is distinguished from all other things by the rectilinear course of its movement, which, so to speak, cuts through the circular movement of biological life. This is mortality, to move along a rectilinear line in a universe where everything, if it moves at all, moves in a cyclical order. The task and potential greatness of mortals lie in their ability to produce things, works and deeds and words, which would deserve to be, and at least to a degree are, at home in everlastingness, so that through them mortals could find their place in a cosmos where everything is immortal except themselves. Note. The Greek language does not distinguish between works and deeds, but calls both erga, if they are durable enough to last and great enough to be remembered. It is only when the philosophers, or rather the sophists, began to draw their endless distinctions and to distinguish between making and acting, poiein and pratein, that the nouns poiemata and pragmata received wider currency. Homer does not yet know the word pragmata, which in Plato, taton anthropon pragmata, is best rendered by human affairs and has the connotations of trouble and futility. In Herodotus, pragmata can have the same connotation. By their capacity for the immortal deed, by their ability to leave non-perishable traces behind, men, their individual mortality notwithstanding, attain an immortality of their own and prove themselves to be of a divine nature. The distinction between man and animal runs right through the human species itself. Only the best, aristoi, who constantly prove themselves to be the best, aristeuein, a verb for which there is no equivalent in any other language, and who prefer immortal fame to mortal things, are really human. The others, content with whatever pleasures nature will yield them, live and die like animals. This was still the opinion of Heraclitus, an opinion whose equivalent one will find in hardly any philosopher after Socrates. In our context, it is of no great importance whether Socrates himself or Plato discovered the eternal as the true center of strictly metaphysical thought. It weighs heavily in favor of Socrates that he alone among the great thinkers, unique in this as in many other respects, never cared to write down his thoughts, for it is obvious that no matter how concerned a thinker may be with eternity, the moment he sits down to write his thoughts, he ceases to be concerned primarily with eternity and shifts his attention to leaving some trace of them. He has entered the vita activa and chosen its way of permanence and potential immortality. One thing is certain, it is only in Plato that concern with the eternal and the life of the philosopher are seen as inherently contradictory and in conflict with the striving for immortality, the way of life of the citizen, the bios politikos. The philosopher's experience of the eternal, which to Plato was ariton, unspeakable, and to Aristotle, anef logu, without word, and which later was conceptualized in the paradoxical nunc stans, the standing now, can occur only outside the realm of human affairs and outside the plurality of men as we know from the cave parable in Plato's Republic, where the philosopher, having liberated himself from the fetters that bound him to his fellow men, leaves the cave in perfect singularity, as it were, neither accompanied nor followed by others. Politically speaking, if to die is the same as to cease to be among men, experience of the eternal is a kind of death, and the only thing that separates it from real death is that it is not final, because no living creature can endure it for any length of time. And this is precisely what separates the vita contemplativa from the vita activa in medieval thought. Yet it is decisive that the experience of the eternal, in contradistinction to that of the immortal, has no correspondence with and cannot be transformed into any activity whatsoever, since even the activity of thought, which goes on within one's self by means of words, is obviously not only inadequate to render it, but would interrupt and ruin the experience itself. Theoria, or contemplation, is the word given to the experience of the eternal, as distinguished from all other attitudes, which at most may pertain to immortality. It may be that the philosopher's discovery of the eternal was helped by their very justified doubt of the chances of the polis for immortality, or even permanence, and it may be that the shock of this discovery was so overwhelming that they could not but look down upon all striving for immortality as vanity and vainglory, certainly placing themselves thereby into open opposition to the ancient city-state and the religion which inspired it. However, the eventual victory of the concern with eternity over all kinds of aspirations toward immortality is not due to philosophic thought. The fall of the Roman Empire plainly demonstrated that no work of mortal hands can be immortal, and it was accompanied by the rise of the Christian gospel of an everlasting individual life to its position as the exclusive religion of Western mankind. Both together made any striving for an earthly immortality futile and unnecessary, and they succeeded so well in making the vita activa and the bios politicos the handmaidens of contemplation that not even the rise of the secular in the modern age and the concomitant reversal of the traditional hierarchy between action and contemplation sufficed to save from oblivion the striving for immortality which originally had been the spring and center of the Vita Activa. Chapter 2. The Public and the Private Realm. 4. Man. A social or a political animal. The vita activa, human life insofar as it is actively engaged in doing something, is always rooted in a world of men and of man-made things which it never leaves or altogether transcends. Things and men form the environment for each of man's activities, which would be pointless without such location. Yet this environment, the world into which we are born, would not exist without the human activity which produced it, as in the case of fabricated things, which takes care of it, as in the case of cultivated land, or which established it through organization, as in the case of the body politic. No human life, not even the life of the hermit in nature's wilderness, is possible without a world which directly or indirectly testifies to the presence of other human beings. All human activities are conditioned by the fact that men live together, but it is only action that cannot even be imagined outside the society of men. The activity of labor does not need the presence of others, though a being laboring in complete solitude would not be human, but an animal laborans, in the world's most literal significance. Man working and fabricating and building a world inhabited only by himself would still be a fabricator, though not homo faber. He would have lost his specifically human quality and rather be a god. Not, to be sure, the creator, but a divine demiurge, as Plato described him in one of his myths. Action alone is the exclusive prerogative of man. Neither a beast nor a god is capable of it, and only action is entirely dependent upon the constant presence of others. Note: it seems quite striking that the Homeric gods act only with respect to men, ruling them from afar or interfering in their affairs. Conflicts and strife between the gods also seem to arise chiefly from their part in human affairs, or their conflicting partiality with respect to mortals. What then appears is a story in which men and gods act together, but the scene is set by the mortals, even when the decision is arrived at in the assembly of the gods on Olympus. I think such a cooperation is indicated in the Homeric erg andron te theonte. The bard sings the deeds of gods and men, not stories of the gods and stories of men. Similarly, Hesiod's Theogony deals not with the deeds of gods, but with the genesis of the world. It therefore tells how things came into being through begetting and giving birth, constantly recurring. The singer, servant of the muses, sings the glorious deeds of men of old and the blessed gods, but nowhere, as far as I can see, the glorious deeds of the gods. This special relationship between action and being together seems fully to justify the early translation of Aristotle's Zoon Politikon by Animal Socialis, already found in Seneca, which then became the standard translation through Thomas Aquinas. Homo est naturaliter politicus, id est socialis. Man is by nature political, that is, social. Note: the quotation is from the Index Rerum to the Taurinian edition of Aquinas, 1922. The word politicus does not occur in the text, but the index summarizes Thomas's meaning correctly, as can be seen from Summa Theologica. More than any elaborate theory, this unconscious substitution of the social for the political betrays the extent to which the original Greek understanding of politics had been lost. For this, it is significant, but not decisive, that the word social is Roman in origin and has no equivalent in Greek language or thought. Yet the Latin usage of the word societas also originally had a clear, though limited, political meaning. It indicated an alliance between people for a specific purpose, as when men organize in order to rule others or to commit a crime. Note: societas regni in Livius, societas sceleris in Cornelius Nepos. Such an alliance could also be concluded for business purposes, and Aquinas still holds that a true societas between businessmen exists only where the investor himself shares in the risk, that is, where the partnership is truly an alliance. It is only with the later concept of a societas generis humani, a society of mankind, that the term social begins to acquire the general meaning of a fundamental human condition. Note: I use here and in the following the word man-kind to designate the human species, as distinguished from mankind, one word, which indicates the sum total of human beings. It is not that Plato or Aristotle was ignorant of or unconcerned with the fact that man cannot live outside the company of men, but they did not count this condition among the specifically human characteristics. On the contrary, it was something human life had in common with animal life, and for this reason alone it could not be fundamentally human. The natural, merely social companionship of the human species was considered to be a limitation imposed upon us by the needs of biological life, which are the same for the human animal as for other forms of animal life. According to Greek thought, the human capacity for political organization is not only different from, but stands in direct opposition to that natural association whose center is the home, oikia, and the family. The rise of the city-state meant that man received, besides his private life, a sort of second life, his bios politikos. Now every citizen belongs to two orders of existence, and there is a sharp distinction in his life between what is his own, ideon, and what is communal, koinon. It was not just an opinion or theory of Aristotle, but a simple historical fact that the foundation of the polis was preceded by the destruction of all organized units resting on kinship, such as the fratria and the file. Note: although Fustel de Coulanges' chief thesis, according to the introduction to The Ancient City, consists of demonstrating that the same religion formed the ancient family organization and the ancient city-state, he brings numerous references to the fact that the regime of the gens, based on the religion of the family and the regime of the city, were in reality two antagonistic forms of government. Either the city could not last, or it must, in the course of time, break up the family. The reason for the contradiction in this great book seems to me to be in Coulanges' attempt to treat Rome and the Greek city-states together. For his evidence and categories, he relies chiefly on Roman institutional and political sentiment, although he recognizes that the Vesta cult became weakened in Greece at a very early date, but it never became enfeebled at Rome. Not only was the gulf between household and city much deeper in Greece than in Rome, but only in Greece was the Olympian religion, the religion of Homer and the city-state, separate from and superior to the older religion of family and household. While Vesta, the goddess of the hearth, became the protectress of a city hearth and part of the official political cult after the unification and second foundation of Rome, her Greek colleague Hestia is mentioned for the first time by Hesiod, the only Greek poet who, in conscious opposition to Homer, praises the life of the hearth and the household. In the official religion of the polis, she had to cede her place in the assembly of the 12 Olympian gods to Dionysos. Of all the activities necessary and present in human communities, only two were deemed to be political and to constitute what Aristotle called the bios politikos, namely action, praxis, and speech, lexis, out of which rises the realm of human affairs, taton anthropon pragmata, as Plato used to call it, from which everything merely necessary or useful is strictly excluded. However, while certainly only the foundation of the city-state enabled men to spend their whole lives in the political realm, in action and speech, the conviction that these two human capacities belonged together and are the highest of all seems to have preceded the polis and was already present in pre-Socratic thought. The stature of the Homeric Achilles can be understood only if one sees him as the doer of great deeds and the speaker of great words. Note: the passage occurs in Phoenix's speech, Iliad Book 9. It clearly refers to education for war and agora, the public meeting, in which men can distinguish themselves. The literal translation is, "Your father charged me to teach you all this, to be a speaker of words and a doer of deeds." mithon te reter eminae prectera te ergon. In distinction from modern understanding, such words were not considered to be great because they expressed great thoughts. On the contrary, as we know from the last lines of Antigone, it may be the capacity for great words, megaloi logoi, with which to reply to striking blows that will eventually teach thought in old age. Note, the literal translation of the last lines of Antigone is as follows: but great words, counteracting or paying back the great blows of the overproud, teach understanding in old age. The content of these lines is so puzzling to modern understanding that one rarely finds a translator who dares to give the bare sense. An exception is Hölderlin's translation. Große Blicke aber, große Streiche der hohen Schultern, vergeltend, sie haben im Alter gelehrt zu denken. An anecdote reported by Plutarch may illustrate the connection between acting and speaking on a much lower level. A man once approached Demosthenes and related how terribly he had been beaten. But you, said Demosthenes, suffered nothing of what you tell me. Whereupon the other raised his voice and cried out, I suffered nothing? Now, said Demosthenes, I hear the voice of somebody who was injured and who suffered. A last remnant of this ancient connection of speech and thought, from which our notion of expressing thought through words is absent, may be found in the current Ciceronian phrase of ratio et oratio. Thought was secondary to speech, but speech and action were considered to be coeval and coequal, of the same rank and the same kind. And this originally meant not only that most political action, insofar as it remains outside the sphere of violence, is indeed transacted in words, but more fundamentally that finding the right words at the right moment, quite apart from the information or communication they convey, is action. Only sheer violence is mute, and for this reason, violence alone can never be great. Even when, relatively late in antiquity, the arts of war and speech, rhetoric, emerged as the two principal political subjects of education, the development was still inspired by this older pre-polis experience and tradition, and remained subject to it. In the experience of the polis, which not without justification has been called the most talkative of all bodies politic, and even more in the political philosophy which sprang from it, action and speech, separated, became more and more independent activities. The emphasis shifted from action to speech, and to speech as a means of persuasion rather than the specifically human way of answering, talking back, and measuring up to whatever happened or was done. Note, it is characteristic for this development that every politician was called a rhetor, and that rhetoric, the art of public speaking, as distinguished from dialectic, the art of philosophic speech, is defined by Aristotle as the art of persuasion. It is in this sense that we must understand the Greek opinion of the decline of Thebes, which was ascribed to Theban neglect of rhetoric in favor of military exercise. To be political, to live in a polis, meant that everything was decided through words and persuasion, and not through force and violence. In Greek self-understanding, to force people by violence, to command rather than persuade, were pre-political ways to deal with people characteristic of life outside the polis, of home and family life, where the household head ruled with uncontested despotic powers, or of life in the barbarian empires of Asia, whose despotism was frequently likened to the organization of the household. Aristotle's definition of man as zoon politikon was not only unrelated and even opposed to the natural association experienced in household life, it can be fully understood only if one adds his second famous definition of man as a zoon logon ekon, a living being capable of speech. The Latin translation of this term into animal rationale rests on no less fundamental a misunderstanding than the term social animal. Aristotle meant neither to define man in general nor to indicate man's highest capacity, which to him was not logos, that is, not speech or reason, but nous, the capacity of contemplation, whose chief characteristic is that its content cannot be rendered in speech. In his two most famous definitions, Aristotle only formulated the current opinion of the polis about man and the political way of life, and according to this opinion, everybody outside the polis, slaves and barbarians, was anephlogu, deprived, of course, not of the faculty of speech, but of a way of life in which speech and only speech made sense, and where the central concern of all citizens was to talk with each other. The profound misunderstanding expressed in the Latin translation of political as social is perhaps nowhere clearer than in a discussion in which Thomas Aquinas compares the nature of household rule with political rule. The head of the household, he finds, has some similarity to the head of the kingdom, but, he adds, his power is not so perfect as that of the king. Not only in Greece and the polis, but throughout the whole of Occidental antiquity, it would indeed have been self-evident that even the power of the tyrant was less great, less perfect, than the power with which the paterfamilias, the dominus, ruled over his household of slaves and family. And this was not because the power of the city's ruler was matched and checked by the combined powers of household heads, but because absolute, uncontested rule and a political realm, properly speaking, were mutually exclusive. Note, the terms dominus and paterfamilias therefore were synonymous, like the terms servus and familiaris. Dominum patrem familiae appellaverunt, servos familiares. The old Roman liberty of the citizen disappeared when the Roman emperors adopted the title dominus. Ce nom, qu'auguste et que tibère encore, repoussé comme une malédiction et un injure. 5. The polis and the household. Although misunderstanding and equating the political and social realms is as old as the translation of Greek terms into Latin and their adaptation to Roman Christian thought, it has become even more confusing in modern usage and modern understanding of society. The distinction between a private and a public sphere of life corresponds to the household and the political realms, which have existed as distinct, separate entities at least since the rise of the ancient city-state. But the emergence of the social realm, which is neither private nor public, strictly speaking, is a relatively new phenomenon whose origin coincided with the emergence of the modern age and which found its political form in the nation-state. What concerns us in this context is the extraordinary difficulty with which we, because of this development, understand the decisive division between the public and private realms, between the sphere of the polis and the sphere of the household and family, and finally, between activities related to a common world and those related to the maintenance of life, a division upon which all ancient political thought rested as self-evident and axiomatic. In our understanding, the dividing line is entirely blurred, because we see the body of peoples and political communities in the image of a family whose everyday affairs have to be taken care of by a gigantic, nationwide administration of housekeeping. The scientific thought that corresponds to this development is no longer political science, but national economy or social economy, or Volkswirtschaft, all of which indicate a kind of collective housekeeping. Note, according to Gunnar Myrdal, the idea of social economy or collective housekeeping, Volkswirtschaft, is one of the three main foci around which the political speculation which has permeated economics from the very beginning is found to be crystallized. The collective of families economically organized into the facsimile of one superhuman family is what we call society, and its political form of organization is called nation. Note, this is not to deny that the nation-state and its society grew out of the medieval kingdom and feudalism, in whose framework the family and household unit have an importance unequaled in classical antiquity. The difference, however, is marked. Within the feudal framework, families and households were mutually almost independent, so that the royal household, representing a given territorial region and ruling the feudal lords as primus inter pares, did not pretend, like an absolute ruler, to be the head of one family. The medieval nation was a conglomeration of families. Its members did not think of themselves as members of one family comprehending the whole nation. We therefore find it difficult to realize that, according to ancient thought on these matters, the very term political economy would have been a contradiction in terms. Whatever was economic, related to the life of the individual and the survival of the species, was a non-political household affair by definition. Note. The distinction is very clear in the first paragraphs of the Aristotelian Economics because it opposes the despotic one-man rule, monarchia, of the household organization to the altogether different organization of the polis. Historically, it is very likely that the rise of the city-state and the public realm occurred at the expense of the private realm of family and household. Note. In Athens, one may see the turning point in Solon's legislation. Coulanges rightly sees in the Athenian law that made it a filial duty to support parents the proof of the loss of paternal power. However, paternal power was limited only if it conflicted with the interest of the city, and never for the sake of the individual family member. Thus, the sale of children and the exposure of infants lasted throughout antiquity. Yet the old sanctity of the hearth, though much less pronounced in classical Greece than in ancient Rome, was never entirely lost. What prevented the polis from violating the private lives of its citizens and made it hold sacred the boundaries surrounding each property was not respect for private property as we understand it, but the fact that without owning a house, a man could not participate in the affairs of the world because he had no location in it which was properly his own. Note, it is interesting for this distinction that there were Greek cities where citizens were obliged by law to share their harvest and consume it in common, whereas each of them had the absolute uncontested property of his soil. See Coulanges, who calls this law a singular contradiction. It is no contradiction, because these two types of property had nothing in common in ancient understanding. Even Plato, whose political plans foresaw the abolition of private property and an extension of the public sphere to the point of annihilating private life altogether, still speaks with great reverence of Zeus Herkios, the protector of borderlines, and calls the horoi, the boundaries between one estate and another, divine, without seeing any contradiction. The distinctive trait of the household sphere was that in it men lived together because they were driven by their wants and needs. The driving force was life itself, the penates, the household gods, were, according to Plutarch, the gods who make us live and nourish our body, which, for its individual maintenance and its survival as the life of the species, needs the company of others. Note, quoted from Coulanges, the reference to Plutarch is Quaestiones Romanae, section 1. It seems strange that Coulanges' one-sided emphasis on the underworld deities in Greek and Roman religion should have overlooked that these gods were not mere gods of the dead, and the cult not merely a death cult, but that this early earthbound religion served life and death as two aspects of the same process. Life rises out of the earth and returns to it. Birth and death are but two different stages of the same biological life over which the subterranean gods hold sway. That individual maintenance should be the task of the man and species survival the task of the woman was obvious, and both of these natural functions, the labor of man to provide nourishment and the labor of the woman in giving birth, were subject to the same urgency of life. Natural community in the household, therefore, was born of necessity, and necessity ruled over all activities performed in it. The realm of the polis, on the contrary, was the sphere of freedom, and if there was a relationship between these two spheres, it was a matter of course that the mastering of the necessities of life in the household was the condition for freedom of the polis. Under no circumstances could politics be only a means to protect society. A society of the faithful, as in the Middle Ages, or a society of property owners, as in Locke, or a society relentlessly engaged in a process of acquisition, as in Hobbes, or a society of producers, as in Marx, or a society of job holders, as in our own society, or a society of laborers, as in socialist and communist countries. In all these cases, it is the freedom, and in some cases so-called freedom, of society which requires and justifies the restraint of political authority. Freedom is located in the realm of the social, and force or violence becomes the monopoly of government. What all Greek philosophers, no matter how opposed to polis life, took for granted is that freedom is exclusively located in the political realm, that necessity is primarily a pre-political phenomenon characteristic of the private household organization, and that force and violence are justified in this sphere because they are the only means to master necessity, for instance, by ruling over slaves, and to become free. Because all human beings are subject to necessity, they are entitled to violence toward others. Violence is the pre-political act of liberating oneself from the necessity of life for the freedom of world. This freedom is the essential condition of what the Greeks called felicity, eudaimonia, which was an objective status depending first of all upon wealth and health. To be poor or to be in ill health meant to be subject to physical necessity, and to be a slave meant to be subject, in addition, to man-made violence. This twofold and doubled unhappiness of slavery is quite independent of the actual subjective well-being of the slave. Thus, a poor free man preferred the insecurity of a daily changing labor market to regular assured work, which, because it restricted his freedom to do as he pleased every day, was already felt to be servitude, douleia. And even harsh, painful labor was preferred to the easy life of many household slaves. Note. The discussion between Socrates and Euthyrus in Xenophon's Memorabilia is quite interesting. Euthyrus is forced by necessity to labor with his body and is sure that his body will not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.